welcome to the Zell Visiting Writer Series. My name is Thea Booty, and I'll be your host for tonight's reading. The Helen Zell Writers Program brings 12 acclaimed authors to the University of Michigan each year to meet with our students and give public readings, craft talks, and Q&As. The series is generously funded by Helen Zell and Janie Lack. And we are thrilled to have Mark Powell here with us for a reading this evening. There's a few announcements before we get started. Please note this event is being recorded and it will be posted on the Zell Visiting Writer Series YouTube. For those on Zoom, closed captioning is enabled. So if you want, you can press the little CC icon at the bottom of your Zoom screen to turn it off or not. We will also post a copy of Mark's reading in the Zoom chat. Here's how tonight's event will be structured. In a minute, Helen Zell Writers Program MFA student Matthew Wamser will introduce Mark Powell. After that, Mark will give a 25-ish minute reading, and then around 6 p.m., another MFA student, Richard Stock, will have a 30-minute conversation with Mark. And for the last 30 minutes, we'll open it to the audience for questions. We have two mics on the side that you can line up for and ask questions. And then those on Zoom, you can type in your question on the chat, and Irby will read your question for you. Okay, so now I'll hand it over to Matthew.
U.S.-funded arms deals gone wrong in eastern Ukraine. Military drone pilots who return home to a drug-ravaged United States. CIA contractors who cannot leave wartime behind after their contracts have ended. These are the sorts of stories of U.S. influence abroad I've seen in the news essentially for as long as I've been able to read. And yet for me, and probably for many of us here today, the world of foreign affairs and government policies is very distant from our everyday considerations, even though it constantly influences all of our lives in subtle and not so subtle ways. Mark Powell's fiction explores the morally ambiguous stories taking place behind those news headlines. I'm particularly reminded of a character in Powell's 2020 novel, Firebird. The man is a former Czech dissident whose parents were murdered by the Soviet Union. He knows the cost of authoritarianism, which is why he fights for democracy in Eastern Europe. But when the novel begins, it is 2013, and he is an old man. He and his followers in the United States work to supply weapons to pro-democracy groups in Ukraine. Like many of Powell's characters, the dissident has the best of intentions, but ultimately his actions only help to destabilize the country in the lead up to a long and destructive war. Many of Powell's characters have ideals, but commit less than ideal acts, surveilling others, destabilizing countries, killing. And when they return home, their experiences and actions linger in their minds, haunting them. Some of them become trapped in cycles of destruction that cannot easily be escaped. In this way, Powell's work humanizes current events. His characters' lives are shaped by foreign policy and the whims of corporations that attempt to profit from instability abroad. His stories allow us to see the interior lives and moral struggles of the people who are agents of government, as well as people whose lives are directly impacted by current events, ranging from veterans returning home to residents of declining small towns in rural America. To read a Mark Powell novel is to see an unflinching portrait of our country in the 21st century. His writing can be violent and filled with psychic and spiritual turmoil, but that is only because he writes unsparingly and truthfully about our world. As the writer of seven novels, including his newest work, Lioness, forthcoming next year, Powell has received fellowships from the National Endowment for the Arts and the Breadloaf and Sewanee Writers Conferences, and twice from the Fulbright Foundation. He has also written about Southern music and culture for the Oxford American, the ongoing Donbass War in Ukraine for the Daily Beast, and his dog for Garden and Gun. In 2009, he received the Chaffin Award for contributions to Appalachian literature, and Ron Rash once heralded Powell as the best Appalachian novelist of his generation. Powell is also an accomplished writing teacher, having taught first at Stetson University in Florida for 8 years, and now at Appalachian State University in North Carolina. He holds degrees from the Yale Divinity School, the University of South Carolina, and the Citadel, training which reflects his wide range of interests, not just in expertly stylized prose, but also in spiritual and moral questions relating to the issues of our day. So it is my great pleasure to introduce Mark Powell to you. Please join me in welcoming him.
Well, Matthew, thank you so much. That's the most generous and mildly delusional in your praise introduction I've ever received. I'm so grateful. Thank you all for coming out, and I'm just so glad to be here. I've had an absolutely wonderful time, and I feel like I'm just getting started, so thank you. And thank you for those who are on Zoom. My family, I believe, is actually watching on Zoom, and my daughter got stung in the face by a yellow jacket today, and I'm just going to say, honey, I'm so glad you're okay. Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm going to read to you a little bit from a novel that's forthcoming in the spring. It's called Lioness. I always envy short story writers here where they can just say, I'm going to read you a story, and you don't have to set it up. This is set where I live, which is in the mountains of northwestern corner of North Carolina, the Appalachian Mountains. It is about a woman who becomes involved in what some people might call an act of eco-terrorism, others might think of as an act of eco-justice. It's told from the point of view of the husband, and it happens after this woman, whose name is Mara, has disappeared and likely been killed in the bombing of a water bottling plant in the hills of southwestern Virginia. And he begins to tell the story, begins to kind of piece back together not only what happened on the night in which the bomb went off, but sort of the larger sense of their life. And what he begins to discover is that what he thought was the case actually wasn't. The man's name is David. His wife is Mara. And they mention two other people that are relevant. One is their son, Daniel. He's passed away 2 years prior to the bomb going off. And another is a man named Chris Bright, who is a longtime activist that the husband believed his wife hadn't seen in many, many years. So let me read you a little bit. This is from Lioness. For years, Mara talked about mountain lions. In the summer after she left, I began to see them everywhere. This was the summer we watched the country burn. Wildfires in California called the Shasta, the Modoc, the Mendocino complex. Political fires in Washington known, we came to realize, as an empire in the throes of death. At night, when I remembered to look up from the cooling ash of my own marriage, I would sometimes walk barefoot out into our yard, our dog Banjo behind me, arthritic and loyal, the owls in the trees above us, the moon above the trees, and above it all, perhaps, God, though I could make no accounting for God. Mara had been gone for nearly a year by then, our son Daniel dead for almost two, but like the entirety of our life together, we existed in a state of flux so that it remained impossible to define what exactly we were, separated, finished. I could never quite say, and that not saying was, I suppose, the cloud that followed me so persistently. I came to think of it as weather, a system as private as it was suffocating. Mara and I had met in the summer of 2002, both of us in our mid-20s, a time when the world was defined by possibility. I was a playwright, or would be soon enough, working the courthouse beat at the Watauga Democrat by day and reading Sam Shepard by night. Mara was working for a nonprofit and painting landscapes, great canvases that were, thanks to the grace of her brushwork, both abstract and representational. Given our current madness, it's hard now to remember the urgency of that time was something new. After the complacent 90s, we were suddenly caught between 9/11 and the coming wars in Iraq. This was the time of anthrax and jihad, of government officials speaking of crusades and plastic sheeting. And what I remember most are the heightened emotions, the anger, the intensity of simply waking every morning into a world quickly becoming unrecognizable. I met Mara at a gathering of what, for lack of a better term, might be called the peace movement, at least as it existed in the mountains of Western North Carolina. And over the course of the next year, we had an affair built around private lust and public fury, an affair furious and brief and very much of the moment. Over the winter of 2003, the world seemed to have acquired a new velocity. Colin Powell spoke before the UN General Assembly about weapons of mass destruction, while the 3rd Infantry Division massed in Kuwait. The 101st Airborne deployed, the 15th Marine Expeditionary Unit, there was an inevitability about it all, and anger too. War was coming, and the people wouldn't stand for it. Then it came, and they did. The thick apathy of support the troops poured over the homeland like cement. Suddenly there were no more marches, no more meetings, just Mara and me and a few old women from Code Pink, half the country cheering for that Yale cheerleader, the other half silent. But not us. Mara and I were loud, at least with each other. We wake naked and touching in her tiny River Street loft, pots of water rattling on the ancient radiator, rage for hours, George fucking Bush, Dick goddamn Cheney, start drinking, start touching. A hopeless cycle that finally fell apart in late 2003. We'd met Chris Bright by then. More accurately, we'd been lured into his gravitational field, helpless to resist the undertow. Not that we wanted to. We moved out to his farm near the North Carolina-Tennessee state line in the early summer of 2003, and whether that delayed or hurried the death of our relationship, I've never been certain. Either way, it ended, and I moved west, hoping to string together magazine assignments while teaching myself to write. When Mara and I met again, almost 3 years and 2,000 miles later, it seemed like more than chance. She'd left Appalachia to study land art, and we sort of just took to each other, drinking box wine and riding around in the convertible Sebring her father had given her a decade prior. It was purely physical then. There was none of the political talk that had defined our time in North Carolina, and that was a good thing. It was the talk that had killed us. The hours in camp chairs down by the river where, caught somewhere between night and day, the joy would turn to sorrow and then, inevitably, to anger. We spent a year in Mexico, house-sitting for an LA couple who were intimates of David Hockney, drinking mezcal and going to sunset parties while Mara painted. We were young and happy and decided to return home to North Carolina and marry. I could sense her slipping away from me. And rather than let it happen a second time, I persuaded her that what she wanted wasn't change, but stability or something like that. Either way, Mara had received an offer to teach at the university back where we had met. It was all, at first, a great success. We bought an abandoned farmhouse deep in the mountains where Mara began work on what would eventually become Alone Beneath the Tree of Knowledge. And I wrote. By May, my play was complete. In June, it was accepted by the Bartram Theater, one of the oldest and most prestigious repertory companies in the country. It would be staged that fall. This was tremendous news to me, and we drove up one glorious summer day to meet the company director. He loved the play. He was already making some stage sketches, thinking about casting, thinking about promotion. We left him in an office crowded with wigs and tailor's dummies and had a champagne lunch we couldn't afford. We were driving home, sun-drunk and listening to Cat Power when Mara told me she was pregnant. It was winter when she told me about the mountain lion. There were things I didn't know, of course. Most marriages are filled with gaps better left unexplored. Old lovers, childhood dreams, there are practical reasons for not prying. There is also the sense of mystery, the way in which your other appears glossed with a hazy furtiveness that can, if understood in the proper context, keep alive a certain magic. I always believed in such, which is why it took me so long to realize Chris Bright had re-entered our lives. He was a few years older and was known as something of a bohemian recluse, living with an aged aunt on a self-sufficient farm deep in the Appalachian Mountains. He was said to be magnetic, and that had proven to be true. Most of the rest wasn't. The stories of wild parties, of heathen excess, nothing could have been more distant from reality. Chris Bright lived with the discipline required of one existing outside the bounds of society. Like his hero Wendell Berry, he farmed and he read. He liked bourbon, but not to excess. His wiry frame owed as much to his time as a distance runner as to manual labor. He was full of both good humor and righteous indignation, but not once did I ever see him lose control. I met him first and soon enough brought Mara out to visit him. I think neither of us was so much in love with him as we were in love with what he stood for, or what we believed he stood for. Again, possibility. In a world of mass marketed death, he was life. In a world of speed and corruption, he was slowest virtue. He was also bearded and thin and appeared not unlike the portraits of Jesus we'd both seen growing up. Even back then, he was obsessed with what he called, what we now all call, our dying planet. climate change, rising seas, the sixth extinction, a day will come, I remember him saying, when they are running pumps in Miami, in Key West, in Mumbai, in New Orleans. Then, sometime later, a day will come when they turn off the pumps and leave the waters to rise. The earth would shake us off, wash us away, and so on. You could tell how bad he wanted it. Some days you could. Other days, he seemed to want nothing so much as to lie in the sun, his toes in the creek sand. We'd float down the Watauga River in inner tubes, feet in the cold water, backs against the warm rubber, lazy, drifting, spinning, all of it glazed with tall boys and the great blue heron that kept pace with us, always just ahead, always just above, lifting on those broad wings you could almost hear. It was worship. We joked about it then, called it the Church of Moving Waters, but I believe it was worship. Mara and I spent 6 months living on his farm, but the intimacy was too much. Here was the political talk that had killed us. I left before Christmas and was in Colorado the night 2003 rolled into 2004. Mara left sometime after, and come August was an MFA student in the Art and Ecology graduate program at the University of New Mexico. I would occasionally think of Chris, but it wasn't until that fall, so many years later, Mara pregnant and working maniacally on her tree, that I heard his name. It was Mara who said it, and as hard as this might be to believe, she said it in her sleep. Or did I say it in mine? Either way, the next day she began to talk about mountain lions. Our house, I cannot yet conceive of it in any other way, sits at the end of a gravel thread that follows a creek for the half mile it winds off a secondary road, that itself sits a few miles off a minor byway that runs the 30 miles between the university in western North Carolina and the deeper hollows of East Tennessee. We had bought the land for both the empty farmhouse and the gigantic barn Mara turned into a studio. It was secluded and it was cheap. The mountains rise on all sides, the darkness of night marred only by the distant lights of the second homes along the ridge. Summer evenings, you can sit on the porch and listen to the sound of the creek gradually give way to the rising cicadas and whippoorwills, the moon climbing from the net of trees to cast our narrow valley in a light as white as bone. Since Mara left, I was spending a great deal of my time on that porch, not exactly thinking about our son Daniel, but not thinking about him either. More like he was present, and though I was numb to his presence, I was still, however dimly, aware of it, the way you might be aware of a draft in the house even as you sleep. Later, when I heard that as a boy, Chris Bright had carried on long conversations with his dead father, I wondered why it had never occurred to me to speak to my own dead son. It was a failure of imagination, I suppose. Perhaps, too, some sort of inborn defense mechanism. I do know that I was drinking more than I should have been, though that's a pretty good descriptor of my adult life. I was out on the porch that September night, the night it began, when I heard the phone go off. The cell signal here is poor, and we'd maintained a landline, something that I consistently forgot to take off the hook. It was after midnight, but I was perfectly awake, having become fully capable of running off bullet rye in my coddled sense of injustice. So it took no great effort to rise from the porch rocker and lumber inside, our old lab banjo following me while I called to the phone to hold on, I'm coming, Jesus. Though I'd spent most of the previous months sitting on the front porch, sweating the July heat into August and then September, I did write the occasional article for Mountain Voice, a regional magazine that focused on environmental issues in the Southern Appalachians. On the line was my editor, Bill Baker, a man I'd known since those early days writing for the Watauga Democrat. We'd started at the newspaper together, and while he had risen to become editor-in-chief of a weekly with offices in 8 towns and a subscription base of 90,000, I had not. I think he probably suspected I was a better writer than him. And it was that guilt, coupled with nostalgia and pity, that led him to call me every few months, requesting 3,000 words on this proposed pipeline or that collapsing coal ash impoundment. That night, he sounded more agitated than usual, and though Bill was very much the proverbial pillar of the community, his had been an upward glide path that leveled off with a 5,000-square-foot house and a dependence on Will Butrin. Like most of us, Bill never quite had been able to hear the music of unhappiness that scored his days. That night, I wondered if, like me, he hadn't sunk deeper into the rye than intended. "Goddamn," he said when I came on the line. "I was afraid you'd be sleeping." "No luck there." "What's that?" "Nothing," I said. "I'm not sleeping much these days." "Right, right," he said. "Of course you aren't. Sleeping's the last thing I'd expect of you. But listen, are you hearing what's coming over the wires up in Virginia?" "I've been listening to the creek." "Jesus, David, and you call yourself a reporter," which I never did. "Listen to this, all right?" Fire was burning at a water bottling plant 2 hours north in Virginia. It had been contained, but the damage sounded substantial. A hazmat team was present, and someone had been chattering over an open channel about the FBI. "You know the place I'm talking about. It bottles for that company, Rain. You remember them, I know." I did. For the last few years, rumors had swirled around the company, and at one point I'd pitched an investigative piece about the parent. They were owned by a local businessman and a Virginia widow, but the rumors held that this was a front for several well-connected political figures, conservative darlings no longer in Washington, but still tied to the establishment by strings of ideology and old boy bullshit. They had bought the well at a bargain price. Though the water had passed all the required tests, it had once been deemed toxic. Bill had shot the pitch down, and after a visit to the office of Rain, I'd let it go. They seemed, if not unimpeachable, at least legitimate. This was the research, the conjecture I had failed to complete. What was a matter of public record, however, was that Rain was in the process of fulfilling a lucrative contract for global evangelical relief, a contract that was likely making the owners, whoever they were, obscenely rich. "I want you to get up there first thing in the morning," Bill said. "You can do that, right?" "Sure, yeah." "Get on this, David. I swear to God, something about this doesn't feel right. Some first responder was jabbering over the scanner, and they just cut the traffic right goddamn off. You can get up there, can't you?" "Of course." "I got a feeling this is tied to some nefarious shit." "Hey, Bill," I said, "didn't I pitch something like this nefarious shit before?" "Yeah, yeah," he said. You were right and I was wrong. I just wanted you to say it. You're the tortured genius, and I'm the pitiful, short-sighted manager, eyeless in Gaza. But get up there, David. I swear there's something more to it." He was almost panting. "Honest to God, it almost sounds like someone set off a bomb. First thing in the morning, all right?" "Yeah," I said. "First thing in the morning." But first thing in the morning found me late and hungover, and I didn't drive to Virginia, not for many hours at least. And when I finally did, it was too late. But then, in a manner of thinking, it had always been too late. I'll stop right there.
Oh,
thank you. I just made up Bill's voice on the spot, and it's rather abrasive. I think I should have thought that through a little more. Yeah, Richard? All right. I don't know. I'm gonna have to think on that one. That's
talking later tonight. I sells real estate, told me this remarkable story about an abandoned water bottle. So apparently after 9/11, like increased security requirements led to a lot of things like water bottle tanks closed because they could not afford the kind of security that was suddenly required, I think, to pay for that. And now they're starting to go, and some of them have said, you can not get for it. So I'm going to do that.
Yes. So it was either this or Richard had to make up his own version of a Bill voice too, something really loud and scratchy.
Oh, well, yeah. Mark, thank you for being here. And
thank you for having me.
And is that the first time Lioness has kind of been spoken?
Yes, actually. And I was doing, hopefully you couldn't see, those are the page proofs, which I have to turn in next week for the production of the book. So I was making a few little marks right there as I read it. So if I was slowing down, thank you for indulging me. I needed to do some line editing.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah. And do you find that, you know, there's revelation in speaking it out loud for the first time. And
I find there is no better time to revise something and see a work clearly than 30 seconds before you have to read it in front of a bunch of people. Nothing focuses the mind like quite like that.
Oh, that's fantastic. I read Firebird in one sitting, punctuated by going to sleep. So two sittings.
Well, God bless you. I appreciate it.
Something I picked up on in Lioness was the states of flux and, you know, fluid situations and moving targets. And it felt to me like that was the basic organization of all things American, and why maybe there's sense to be found in that fractured family and the big American political project, like both marching forward. I don't know where this question's going.
I don't know. I like it. Keep going.
But is there a sense to be mapped onto that that family in Lioness and then the larger mechanism of the American war machine?
Yeah, you know, I grew up in an incredibly in a wonderful place, but a very conservative, small southern town, and I think I grew up with these notions of America, right? Like the greatness of democracy and so forth. And you don't have to read much or spend much time outside the United States to realize that our presence is often not only unwelcome, but it's deeply damaging, right? And to a certain degree, we live under this larger umbrella of violence, right? The products we consume, the safety in which we live. And I think many people don't realize sort of the reverberations of this unless they have someone who's directly impacted. So I don't know, it was like this idealistic shell with me got cracked, and that was all I wanted to write about, is how these things are sort of, how they shake us. There's a quote in a Don DeLillo novel I absolutely love called Players. Mm-hmm. And he says in it, he's talking about some people watching a terrorist attack, and he says, "Here's a lesson in the intimacy of distance." And I felt sort of since 9/11, which I guess kind of is like the definitive act, I was 24 when that of my life, or my coming of age as a writer, is I feel like we as Americans have been schooled in something the world has long known, which is this lesson in the intimacy of distance. Mm-hmm. This idea that most of the violence we see in the world is far away and abstract, yet there is this lingering possibility that it could affect us very quickly and very randomly. Mm-hmm. I don't know where I'm going with this answer, like your question, but yeah, I think that's something that's worth exploring.
That's fascinating to me that the unity of your idea of the American experience was shattered a little bit, maybe later in life than felt comfortable in, so mm-hmm. then became fascinated with it. I know that when I started thinking about America as not entirely perfect, I became a radical communist pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. A little bit of an overcorrection, you know.
As one does, right?
Yeah. Now I'd say democratic socialist, but, you know. I'll get into my Letterman cards here. So I noticed in reading Firebird, it had this fascinating ability to bloom, and that got me thinking about form mm-hmm. because it's a thriller. And so, especially around characters Sarah and Marco, the novel could, you know, sweep into passionate movements and histories. And so my question was about the blooming. Where are the rails on a thriller? You obviously can't stop to invent languages and visit mm-hmm. Tom Bombadil in the woods. So what are the formal constraints working in that form?
Oh, I don't know. I thought that book was my attempt to write not so much like a literary novel, but a thriller. Mm-hmm. And I think I failed at it because it's neither a literary novel nor a thriller. It's like the least thrilling thriller you could ever read, or the least literary. I don't know. It's something. A friend of mine said, oh, it's just between, you know, there's the literary chair and the thriller chair, and you're between the two, which I've come to realize means you've like fallen flat on the floor if you've missed the middle. I don't know, like to write something like a thriller requires this kind of narrative propulsion that has to keep moving rapidly. Mm-hmm. But ultimately what I'm interested in is what it does to individuals. And that's something, in some sense, right, these genre definitions are kind of false, but there are some conventions I think that hold true. What I'm interested in is the way it affects individual people. And that's what we could kind of go to literary fiction, right, or psychological fiction for. So it's really tricky. And I don't think I did it well. I think at times I moved the plot too rapidly to explore characters, and at times I moved it too slowly to make it a thriller. Mm-hmm. So your question is a great one. And if you can answer, like, where are the rails? I would love to know, because I don't know. But I think as with all writing, right, it's something that you kind of feel your way, that sense of walking into a room and there's no lights on and you just start groping at the walls, right, until you hit the switch. I'm not sure I found the switch, but I was certainly groping.
Yeah, I didn't think about the rails until I noticed that the novel was interested in things outside of a thriller, like this American absurdism and mm-hmm. modernity, and especially with Marco, he had a full character swing. And so I noticed the rails when the novel bloomed and spilled and pooled into these places that didn't feel strictly like a Tom Clancy move. Mm-hmm. So that's when I noticed them. So I guess, you know, there's a sense that it's all building and weaving towards this one collision at the end. And mm-hmm. anywhere there was a little bit of a slowdown, I'd say that I noticed as a rail.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the classic convention of the thriller, right? That you, yeah. And I also realized that in my previous comment, I said in context, but I said I was definitely groping, which just sounds weird. I'm sorry. So we'll redact that.
Yeah, I don't think we have that technology.
We don't have that technology. Well, I have a feeling I happen to know from experience with my own students that the closed captioning on Zoom is not really great with a Southern accent. So maybe we're fine.
You might be off the hook.
Yeah.
So my next question is about place, roots, and regionalism. And you're from the place. Walhalla, South Carolina.
Yes.
I have the luxury of being from a suburb to a suburb, mm-hmm. Westlake Village, California. So no one ever will accuse me of joining any regionalist tradition. Mm-hmm. But your writing has established you in the Southern Appalachian literary tradition. And do you feel like that label follows you at all into places it might not be entirely appropriate, like into Firebird, which is...
Yeah, I mean, yeah. You know, a wonderful writer who was a mentor to me, Ron Rash, said, whenever somebody calls you like a... whatever the region is, it's hard sometimes not to hear adjust in front of that, you know, like adjust a sort of writer. So in some sense, I think that is limiting, but I think all of us, I mean, even if you are from a suburb of, you know, in Northern California, north of LA, we're all products of the world in which we were. I mean, we were all steeped to differing degrees. I was really steeped. I was like that tea bag you forgot to take out. But we're all steeped in that, right? And it sort of constructs the lens through which we see the world. And for wherever I live, I left my hometown when I was 17 and effectively didn't live back in the mountains until a few years ago. I lived in the Northeast, I lived in Florida, I lived abroad. Nevertheless, despite all that, I'm always seeing the world through the lens of like this rural Southern kid who grew up going to church, you know, constantly. So no matter where my stuff is set, I know that is the way I experience the world. So I think while I'm like, come on, y'all, this book's set in Ukraine or somewhere. I still am who I am in that sense. And I think I always will be. You know, we write in response to, I've come to think, not even so much like our childhoods, but the narratives we construct around our childhood. I can no longer exactly even remember what my childhood was like exactly, but I know very well the stories that I've told now so that they've kind of become bedrock. And I'm writing in response to that, like, sense of narrative I've created. I don't know if that makes any sense, but...
A whole lot.
Okay, good. Well, thank you.
Yeah, and Lioness, much closer to home. And I was wondering if there's some feeling of being under attack. I know earlier you mentioned the style of mining.
Yeah, mountaintop removal, yeah.
Does it just feel like the Appalachians, like your mountain home, like it's actually being... you know, ripped away?
Well, I mean, Appalachia is effectively like an inner colony in the United States, and it has been historically, right? It's been stripped for timber, it's stripped for coal, it's been stripped for cheap labor, right, in, you know, all sorts of industries. It's always been treated like that. It was a testing ground for Purdue Pharma and opioids, right? This is what we're going to do. We're going to pump these into every small town and holler up and down the I-81 corridor. It feels like it's always under attack. It's far more diverse than people would have you believe. It's far more interesting than people would have you believe. And I wrote, you know, I was writing this book, over the past, I don't know, 3 or 4 years or something. And as I was finishing it up, I was thinking it was looking very likely, like we would very possibly have a second Trump presidency. And I'm always interested in the question of violence. And in fact, I'm going to give my craft talk tomorrow on that. But when, if ever, violence is justified, and in light of what we know about the climate, in light of what we know about everything, I sort of felt myself revisiting that question of at what point is violence justified, to not just to defend a particular place, but to defend the planet, right?
Well, that feels central to Lioness, right? With the
eco-terrorist
or mm-hmm. eco-warrior.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, eco-justice, you could say, right? And I don't have that answer, but I always kind of write out of a place of confusion. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm trying to figure out what I think about something. I think often about the Chekhov quote, right? The job of the artist isn't to solve the problem, but to state the problem correctly. So I'm always trying to like state that problem correctly for me, right? I'm trying to explain the world to myself to make it comprehensible. And when you start thinking about these things, like what steps would be justifiable, right? If the tops are literally blasted off mountains, right? What's the response to that, right? And I don't know. I mean, I don't know. Thankfully, that's why I'm a writer, right? Not right. Like I would make a terrible activist. but you know, I think these are things that are worth, at least to me, worth spending time thinking about. So certainly Lioness is much more in line with that.
And here's the question. It's titled Plot and Conspiracy.
All right. I like it already. Is that the question? The answer is yes.
It says, in an interview with Mountain Times, which actually just appeared in what you read, in January of last year, you said about energy and politics in the region of Eastern Europe, that those connections, the ones in your book, felt far-fetched but strangely possible. As a novelist, I couldn't resist. Is some part of being a novelist believing the conspiracy? Mm-hmm. And does it slip into your real life at all? I saw you mentioned in Firebird, like reptilian overlords. And
yeah, but as an endorsement, actually. So just let's be clear on that for everyone. I don't believe in conspiracy theory. I believe in market forces. I believe in the power and the influence of multinational corporations and absolute uninhibited greed. And I think that is probably, I mean, we're not competent enough to pull off any kind of decent conspiracy, right? Yeah. But we are greedy enough to wreck things. My family and I, we were living for a while, a brief period in Slovakia, and the war had started next door in Ukraine. And I just got really interested about, like, why Ukraine, right? Why is this happening? And I got interested in these vast deposits of natural gas that are sitting underground in Ukraine. And there's American and Western European companies pumping gas, you know, and there's Russian companies pumping gas, and they own the market. It isn't far-fetched to think that keeping that gas in the ground is really beneficial for market prices. That is kind of a conspiracy theory, but also it is like market forces, right? There's no incentive not to have a low intensity conflict in a place like Ukraine if it means companies continue to make trillions of dollars off the energy market or whatever market it is, right? Mm-hmm. I had mentioned to you earlier when we were just chatting that in the early 2000s, in like 15 lives ago, I was a divinity student and I got really interested in going to Colombia. This was the period when the violence was going on between the FARC, Marxist guerrillas. In their larger incarnation, they're terrorist groups. In their local incarnation, they were often just poor farmers who had been displaced from their land. And they were fighting against these sort of government-backed militias. And largely, I mean, these things were at the behest of large corporations, and they would come in and they would push poor people off the land. Then they would slash the land and they would plant like a palm oil plantation, right, to make cosmetics or whatever it may be, some kind of monoculture crop. And it wasn't like a conspiracy theory of all these people pulling these strings. It was just the fact that you could make this stuff really, really cheap down there. And it wasn't hard to terrorize some local people and move them off. So to plotting conspiracy, that's my answer.
Okay.
Yeah, did that solve it?
That did, yeah.
Okay,
and then
excellent.
It also answered one of my next questions too, is I was wondering about the genesis of a novel set in Ukraine. And it sounds like it's because there was something unsettled there in your mind, something that you didn't know. Mm-hmm. And so it's, you know, there's not a novel about every place that you've lived.
I've tried. Most of them just didn't work. Yeah. No. You know, it's just when you run into those things and you can't explain them. Mm-hmm. And maybe you can explain them geopolitically, but you still can't like quite make sense of what it feels like that's a war effectively in Europe, mm-hmm. which just seems absolutely to me unheard of, right? There's the war, the Yugoslav wars of the 90s, but other than that, it's just the Second World War. It just doesn't seem like it should exist. So it was just something that kind of got its hooks in me and I couldn't quite let go of until I wrote about it.
Mm-hmm. I have another one. It's called Modernity and Mark Powell.
These are titled impeccably, I want to add.
And a very common motif, even theme in Firebird is kind of the absurdity of the modern technological state. And I was just wondering, how natural are vapes and Instagram and MacBook anarchists to you? Or do you have to go find that world, or do you feel it encroaching?
So, you know, the great thing about being a writer is I feel like, and maybe you feel like this way too, I feel like I never quite belong anywhere fully. Like I've always got one foot in one world and one foot in the other. So, you know, I went to the military. I'm going to get back to vaping and MacBooks. So I promise, because how could I not? You know, like I went to a military college, and I didn't go in the military, but all my friends did. I went to a very liberal divinity school where most of the people became, if not some kind of like social justice, in some sort of social justice work. But I didn't go into that. So I feel like it gives me sort of this purview of things. And in that sense of never quite, like when I went to divinity school in the Northeast, and people were always, they always thought I was just a little bit slow. And they would, you know, because of my accent, they thought my wife was utterly charming, and they thought I was just like a, you know, an idiot Billy Bob Thornton walking around, sling blade. It can be advantageous, right? Because you can just sort of feel like you can stand on the corner and people forget about you, and you can just pay attention. Mm-hmm. So I did move for a short period of time with people who were those people. You know, they were sitting there with their MacBooks and they were plotting revolution in air quotes. They were not. They probably work for Goldman now. But I got to see kind of that side of it. What was the other things you were asking about? I want to hit them all.
Does it help that you teach? Are you?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I constantly pay attention to my students, and they correct me all the time on things that I get wrong. But I have realized that my characters are just going to have to get older and older, because I am losing a grip on any sort of sense of youth. I think teaching helps a lot.
Yeah.
I mean, you spend your days discussing books and stories with smart young people.
Mm-hmm.
How could that go wrong, right?
Yeah. I have a similar experience teaching.
Oh. That's the best, right?
Yeah.
It's going to be Richard in modernity.
So here's a fun one. It's called male bed sharing.
Male bed sharing?
Yeah.
M-A-L-E or M-A-I-L, just to be clear?
M-A-L-E.
Let's do it.
You've joined the pantheon of books with two guys sharing one bed scene. When you put Hugh and Marco in a hotel room that came with one queen bed instead of two fulls. Did you feel a pressure, challenge, or responsibility to live up to that famous scene in Moby Dick with Ishmael and Quique?
This was my homage to such. I'd totally forgotten about that scene, but obviously I hadn't. It's clearly embedded up here. So yes, and that your title was far better than my answer. So I feel a responsibility actually less to Melville than to your title.
Well, maybe there can be a special edition. So this one's handwritten, so it might be worse, but it says, you've published six novels now. Is it six or seven?
It's six, yeah. This will be seven in the spring.
Okay. And is much of what you've learned about writing a novel single use, or is it a lot easier now? Is there stuff that carries over?
It's both, right? I mean, so, I like the thing, like single use, like cutlery, you know, like, yeah, one time it's done. So I think what I've learned is to be patient with myself, which I know is like the worst of cliches, but is quite true. I was talking this morning with Kelsey about when I first started writing, you know, and I think this is not unique to me. You read a novel and you love it, and you're like, oh my God, I'm going to write a novel just like that. And you write 15 pages, but by then you've read another novel and you're like, actually, I love that novel. And you start a new one. Eventually, of course, you have to you have to stick. But what I've found now is that I'm able to not dive into something. I'm able to to sit with it and think about it longer than I would have. So in that sense, I think, you do get better. And Hemingway had that great quote, which I think I mentioned to you earlier, you know, the interior decorating gets easier, the architecture remains hard, right? You do become a better writer, right? On the line level, I think. But every book has to find its own structure. And structure to me is the most interesting thing when you're constructing a novel, probably because it's the most difficult, right? And the structure has to you have to divine it like you're, divining for water each time. So yes and no. Yeah, some parts of it do get easier.
Yeah, and do you think the structure might have drawn you to Firebird? Because that's a tight, rotating, close focus, four different points of view, and a thriller. So they all have to build and play together.
Yeah, I mean, the structure was going to kill me. It was like this huge sprawling book at one point. But I love those novels where you get multiple third person. I mean, like Anna Karenina's like this, right? You get these multiple third person, you move between them. And maybe it's not exactly clear early on how they're connected, but they bind as the novel goes forward. I've always loved that. And I felt like that's sort of the default way in which I want to write. So yes, yeah.
And did it feel like when you were picking which point of view was up next or moving the book on, was there a maypole that everything was braiding around? Like, was there some spine?
I mean, theoretically, yes, right? I mean, it's like juggling. You've got to keep these balls in the air and you can't keep one up there too long or the others are going to fall. So you try to balance that, right? But then, God, it's just tricky. You know, I spent years taking novels I love that do this. Like I mentioned earlier to you today, the writer Robert Stone, right? Who his novels, which I think were like successful literary thrillers, and he would have maybe three or four points of view. And when the novel started, they're completely disconnected, but slowly they come together and they bind. I love that sort of thing. And he's one of my favorite writers, but it's hard, right? It's really difficult. This is the first thing that I read that I've ever written this first person. And I mean, not like the first thing I've published, like the first thing I've ever read. And I've fallen in love with those Joan Didion-esque narrators that sort of frame the tale, mm-hmm. like the Nick Carraway, right? The privileged viewer who is sort of the story, but also sort of able to kind of narrate it and take us through. And then you can drop that narrator out. It's like a disappearing first person narrator, right? Because you can go into long stretches of third person and then the narrator can come in to reorient you. So I really like that, but now I feel like I'm cheating.
Yeah,
because it feels easier than trying to balance those third person points of view.
I love those as well, the Nicks and the disappearing first, because I feel like they have a lot to offer on the second read. Because on the first one, you're fascinated with what they're fascinated with. On the second one, you can keep them a little closer track of them.
Yeah.
I'm not ready for that. I'm still working in
this. Well, and that's actually, I hadn't even thought of that, but that's a great way of thinking about it, right? You're hearing the story they're telling the first time, but on later reads, you're actually, all right, well, who is this person who's speaking to me? What is her perspective on this? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. Writing from known artifacts.
Okay.
I wanted to talk about writing from real artifacts, cultural artifacts, political ones, empty slates, blank templates, possibly Marco Rubio.
Yeah, I mean, I was writing that book while we were living in Florida, and you know, dear Marco was everywhere.
Yeah,
and he's a hard to like guy, you know.
Right, because you have Marco Torres, who's a bit of a patsy, right wing, empty ideologue of a congressman from Florida.
Yeah,
but pretty quickly he became Marco, book Marco.
Right. Yeah. I mean, you start with that, right? It's like this little cheat you have to give yourself sometimes. Writing fiction is so hard, right? I mean, it's really difficult to do. So I always feel like anything that can get me moving in one direction is fine, because I know over the process of writing something, all right, I may start out thinking about Marco Rubio, right? This kind of crass opportunist who was going to seize on whatever I clearly don't have strong feelings about this. You know, he's going to seize on whatever he can to move his career forward to the detriment of his constituents, to the detriment of whatever. I think it's fine to start with that, right? If that gets you started, knowing that these things are going to morph and they're going to change over time. So starting with a real person, a real event, knowing that that's just the way in which, you know, it's like the thing pushing the car, right, to get it rolling. So yeah, that's kind of a frequent thing for me.
Yeah, I mean, he became the most tragic hero, in my opinion.
Yeah, I hate that happened. But
Marco Rubio.
Yeah, I mean, my apologies.
No, so clearly it became your own fiction.
Yeah.
How are we on time, Thea?
10.
Oh, well, I got questions. So I had a question. It's a little prudential for my current situation as an author, but it's called Letting a Draft Settle. And do you let your drafts cool on the windowsill, and how long, and what pulls you back into a draft for a rewrite?
I always treat them like pies. Yeah, you know, you got to let them cool. Yeah, so I always keep two projects going, and usually one is in later stages and one is in earlier stages, because you reach a point where I think, I'm just sick of it, right? You're absolutely sick of the thing. And you're blind to it. You know, you go back and you're reading it, but actually you're just gliding down the page, and that's useless. So that's the point where I go to the other project and I work on the other project. And usually what happens is I get sick of that project. So thus I go back to the other one. Mm-hmm. And then by then, right, you're seeing it with fresh eyes. You also reach a point, especially with a novel, and I don't write much short fiction, and this might be true of short fiction too, but you get to the point with a novel where you're just really sick of it, right? And there's a novel, there's a preciousness about it. You're like, this is my baby. And there's things in here I'm not going to cut. But if you do that long enough, right? If you sit with it, if it cools on the windowsill long enough, eventually you get so frustrated, you lose all emotional attachment and you just start slashing the thing. My novel, Small Treasons, I remember I'd worked on it for a couple of years, just like tinkering with it, like little tweaks here and there. And finally, there was one weekend, I looked at it, I'd printed it out. I was at a writing retreat. I had like 4 days and I was like, you know what? I just want to be done with this book. And all of a sudden I was capable of just like making these massive structural changes, these cuts. And I did more in like 4 days than I had in, I don't know, a year prior. Mm-hmm. And it was exactly what needed to be done. But I just had to get to the point where I could do that to it. And it was just a process of time.
Yeah, it's kind of like the enemy changes from what's between you and a book at first, is that you don't have anything. And then eventually what's between you and a book is you have this whole thing.
Yeah, exactly, right? Yeah. This thing I made, it's killing me, yeah. Right? I'm dragging it around, yeah.
If I understand it, you can only write in brief windows where you're not sick of the thing that you're currently writing.
Yeah, but you got something else you're not sick of, right. So you can always be working on something. Yeah, you can move between the projects, for sure.
So next one, it's called Godard, semicolon, author versus auteur. And this was in Firebird, I was a little tickled at the inclusion of a Godard film, and specifically the mention of it confusing Hugh Eckert, not in the plot, but in the timeline. So was that at all, was that at all a nod to your process or job as a person writing in a form that like demands an authority around its basic facts, when Godard can just kind of settle on interesting things and he doesn't have to worry about?
Yeah, I'm trying to remember the Godard film they're talking about. It's about Simone Weil.
The Band of Outsiders or?
Something Love, I can't remember. But anyways, I remember watching that in a little art house theater many, many, many years ago. And just being blown away by it and moving it, being so moved by it. And then I watched it a few years ago and I just could not make sense of it. And it's completely nonlinear. My son said, when I said, I can't make sense of this film anymore. My son's like, Dad, you can't even figure out how to put a thumb drive in, you know, into your computer. How did you think you were going to make sense of the plot of this? And I realized it's just like this thing of like getting older. Mm-hmm. I don't know. My brain, I don't know if your brain is not as plastic or you just get set in your ways. It wasn't a comment on me so much. It was a comment on what I feel like is like this generational divide that I sit. There are people just a few years younger than me. I feel like I sit on the other side of one, of a divide. And it's the divide of not growing up with like an internet or social media, right? That stuff didn't kind of arrive until I was well into my 20s. Mm-hmm. The internet was before that, of course, but not like pervasive. So I feel like there's people that are just a few years younger than me, but we are on the opposite sides of this chasm. And I was trying to get at that in the book, particularly when you have, I was kind of writing too in the shadow of the Occupy movement, mm-hmm. right? And if you have any familiarity with the Occupy movement, you know, there was this real tension between people like my age or a little older who had been kind of like singing the left song for a long time, and then younger people who were rightfully just dismissive of like people in their 40s. Mm-hmm. Like, please don't tell us what to do. You've had your time to make these changes, and look, you haven't. So I wanted to play with that notion too.
Yeah, and is it hard to keep up with, I feel like there's micro generations now. Like I did college without Uber. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that is somehow a generation.
I mean, perhaps. I do know that I loaded Lyft on my phone for this trip and used it this morning. And I was so proud of myself. I actually texted my wife to tell her I pulled it off because she was concerned. But it worked.
Yeah.
So maybe there are. Yeah. And I saw there's a thing in the Times this week with someone, or maybe it's the New Yorker, saying like, we must do away with the notion of generations. It's a sort of a false reading of social science. Mm-hmm. I haven't read the article, but without reading it, I'm just, as an American, I'm going to go ahead and disagree with the premise.
Yeah, they got a paywall now. I don't really go in there.
Well, there you go. That alone makes us not read it.
Well, yeah, it used to be your life looked kind of similar to your dad's, and his life looked pretty much like his dad's. And now an eighth grader at a school might not have a similar life to a 12th grader because of different.
Right. Yeah. These little microclimates or micro generations. I have a friend who's a little older than me, and he says, he claims there was a similar thing that happened. And I don't know if this is true, but he swears by it. When MTV became prevalent in houses, like, I don't know when that would have been, maybe like the mid to late 80s or maybe mid 80s. The difference between people who grew up, like went to high school watching or middle school watching MTV and those who discovered it in their 20s. And he believes there's this profound gap there, which may or may not be true. I can't speak to that, but.
I was a little bit after MTV, although I do remember our first internet browser. Dad gathered us around. Mm-hmm. Net Zero is free. It had a huge big banner. Mm-hmm. So I feel a little bit pre-internet.
Yeah. I remember walking across the room with the phone line to plug it in the jack, you know, so the boop, boop, boop.
Yeah. And if you remember, those speakers could predict an incoming phone call. They would pick up. Anyway.
Oh, yeah. Is this on the card?
This is just pre-internet stuff. Yeah. I don't know how old the audience is, but. Okay, I asked that one. Oh, I was fascinated with farce and form and thriller and where they might connect with respect to all things American, mm-hmm. where kind of the stakes of anything American are going to be high enough to demand a thriller, like mm-hmm. you can change the world and kill people and enact your will, basically. But then the facts of all things American will bend anything towards a farce, where you've got these flimsy human linchpins and just cascading events. And I'd wondered about that line and if you ever found it, because I know, say, for example, Dr. Strangelove, mm-hmm. it originally ended with a pie throwing scene in the war room, mm-hmm. and it ended up being like having some of the most tense sequences of all time. Mm-hmm. And I wondered if you ever found that line in writing Firebird.
I think frequently, right, about, you know, first is tragedy, then is farce. Mm-hmm. And we are certainly in the farcical stage of history. Maybe every generation feels like that, or every period in time has a farcical stage. But yeah, I don't know where that line exists, but it is this kind of absurdity to it. Mm-hmm. And it's going to get more pronounced, you know. I mean, that's if anything, this pandemic is a dry run at which we performed very poorly for what is coming, right? Mm-hmm. For the kind of climate apocalypse, I think that we're going to face, and maybe here in particular areas in the United States, we won't face it, but we're going to watch it unfold, right, in that intimacy of distance. Yeah. So I don't know about farce, but it's definitely there. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did you do, were you a prolific pandemic writer, or did you have other things going on?
Yeah, no, I was, so we were in, my family and I, we were in Romania when things fell apart, and we were living in, so we were already sort of in a little form of isolation. We were living in this tiny little communist era flat, and all of a sudden we got rushed home in what felt like this really kind of panicked moment. I mean, I've been in a lot of crazy places before, and I've never been so nervous as getting home with my family. And then we got home, and we live on the side of a mountain, essentially what I described as in the Lioness is where we live. So it was this wonderful freeing thing, and I just like floated light as a feather for a while to be safely, because we thought we were going to, for the first we thought we'd be stuck in Romania, and then we thought we were going to be stuck in Turkey after the EU closed. But we made it. So yeah, I was incredibly prolific. And then I just kind of burned through everything. And I had a summer of just moping around, feeling sorry for myself.
Yeah, I remember early on, I was laughing. I was like, pandemic, my life's the exact same. I sit home and write. And,
yeah.
But then, yeah, it eventually.
Yeah, eventually, yeah, it adds up, right? And then eventually you start to, you think like, oh, this is kind of nice. I have all this time to write. And then you're reminded that, you know, hundreds of thousands of people are dying. And you're like, shit, this is actually, I feel guilty for feeling like for even thinking about that, but yeah, but that's the, and maybe that's the farcical side of it, right? You hear people say, I hear this all the time, like people say like, I had a really great pandemic, yeah, which is, I understand that in the day-to-day sense, right? Like I got a lot of stuff done. I was with my family. I wasn't all of these things, but then, I mean, it's like a horrible thing to say, right? At the same time. So maybe the farcical side is that notion that we, more and more, we're keenly aware of the idea that we live in this tension, right? We're not going to arrive at any answers. We're not going to arrive at any easy conclusions. And we're just going to have to be comfortable in that place.
Yeah, and it's also, I feel like it might speak to our ability to process things at a particular scope. So the whole thing hard, but our daily life or our family, a lot easier. And that, I remember in Lioness, there was this cool smashing of an infidelity in the marriage, and then Colin Powell at the UN Assembly General. And it's like, oh, I get it now. I get what, I don't know. So there was sense to be found from the small and the big. Did I get that right? Was there?
Yes, okay. You got it right. Yeah. Yes, you're an not only astute reader, you're an astute listener. So you did get it right.
Thank you. I did get into Michigan somehow. but I think too much, they gave me a class to teach. Yeah, zero more would be great. I think I'm out of cards.
we've exhausted the titles.
Yeah.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I think we're going to Zoom questions now. Audience.
If you do have a question, and you may not, but if you do, I would ask that you title it, please.
We're going to have to start going into the ones that I crossed out.
Oh, no, and I can see these. We should avoid them.
They're not titles.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hi.
You mentioned failure a couple of times on stage tonight, both talking about trying to set novels in places that you lived and also trying to write a thriller. And I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit about what role failure plays in your process.
God, I mean, I feel like, you know, failure is my métier, you know, it's like I don't mean to sound negative, and I guess I do, if you use failure repeatedly, right? You do mean to sound negative to some degree. I don't know, I think failure for anybody who's trying to do something, particularly something artistic, is something you should probably just embrace. And I remember a wonderful line, I think it was Faulkner, who said something like, he had no interest in the small successful books. He liked the big magnificent failures. I love the writer, I mentioned Joan Didion earlier. Another one I love is the late Dennis Johnson. And I always feel like his books are these messy sorts of things that aren't perfect novels, but are more beautiful for the fact that they don't quite work because they try so much. They try to do so much. I'm going to regress this even more. So you know how when you're growing up, you often hear like you can be anything, you know, that's a common thing that's told to children, which is a horrible thing, you know, to tell children. And you know, like, I feel like adults should do better than that, because it does make you, or it made me grow up with this idea that you can touch the hem of the garment, right? You can achieve these things, and it's completely false. So I guess I think about that a lot, because I want to be comfortable with that, because I think that allows me to try more as a writer. Or, and by try more, I mean like attempt things that I would be not exactly scared to attempt, but I wouldn't otherwise. I don't know. That was a really good question. I'm kind of like psychoanalyzing myself now. But I think it's something that I don't want to run from and be like, oh my God, I'm afraid this book's going to be a failure. I just want to go into it being like, yeah, this book is going to fail. It's definitely not going to achieve or do what I want it to do. I'm not going to get to that place, but I'm going to get somewhere, and I want to try to get, you know, and I don't know where. So I'm not going to allow that fear to inhibit it. I don't know. Well, thank you, but sorry not to give you a better answer. Oh, thank you.
There are two questions.
Uh-huh. Oh, I mean, so here's what I think. And this is actually, I've really kind of wrestled with this when writing this craft lecture for tomorrow. I think if, as an artist doing anything, if you don't feel like you have ideological or moral or ethical responsibilities, you don't. If, however, that answer is not satisfying and it's not for me, it's something I think that has to be reckoned with individually. So I think, like, on the whole, there are no sort of, the only responsibility is to the work itself, right? To make the best work you can. But if you don't feel like that's enough, if you feel like you needed to be engaged somehow with the world, then that's something you've got to come to terms with. And I think that's what I'm, in my work, that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to come to terms with that. Tell Dave that was a good question.
Yeah.
Oh, he heard me, didn't he? Yeah.
I will. And there's another question from Drew, and he asks, on the subject of eco-terrorism, I was wondering if, Mark, if you have read How to Blow Up a Pipeline by Andreas Mom, and if you have, what you thought of it.
No, I haven't. Is How to Blow Up a what?
How to Blow Up a Pipeline.
Oh. No, I'm not, but I will. That sounds very much like something I would be interested in. So I appreciate the recommendation.
I'm afraid to Google that.
I was writing, so my fifth novel, part of the story is about the radicalization of a young man who lives in Atlanta, who is sort of moving toward an ISIS-like cell, in a terrorist cell in the United States. And I was making the most horrific Google searches you could imagine, right? And I was getting a little bit worried because all that's accruing somewhere. And then at some point I realized at the time I didn't have a Google account. My wife did. So it was all accruing under her name. Like, I'm fine. They're going to knock on the door for her, but I'm going to be no worries.
I did cross out a similar question. And it was, if you show an aptitude to write in this space of espionage and American politics, do the guys in the van show up and give you money to write Jack Ryan season 3? Or
are they coming? I don't know. Yeah. I'm waiting on them. I'll take it. Yeah. Listen, I'll be happy to. They have no idea how cheaply I'll sell out. I've got 2 kids, you know. They just got to try me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Hello.
Hi.
Kind of, you've touched on it a little bit in a couple of different places, but I'm interested in your kind of research process and how you balance kind of like lived experience in like this cultural period. And like, I don't know, it sounds like your novels have like this vast sweeping historical and cultural settings that I'm guessing require a little bit of research outside of what you just know. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering how you go about balancing the kind of objectivity of research with connecting to
right.
the human side of things.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's a great question, and balancing is always a difficult thing. Whenever I get interested in something, it's usually I've gotten interested in it, not from so much like hearing about it or reading about it, is I've had some kind of experience that brought me in contact with it, if only in a glancing sort of way. And usually what happens is I get interested in something and I learn a lot about it before I start to write about it, before I ever, we were talking about this at lunch today. I am a big believer when you're writing a novel, like you need to move rapidly through a novel and not get through the writing of a novel, or at least through a draft, and not get bogged down too much in those details. So I try to think this stuff through before, and then write, but also, it's fiction, like, right. You know, you want to have details that if someone knew this, they wouldn't say, oh, that's wrong. Right. You got this, you didn't get this correct. But in the end, you're like trying to tell a story. That's the job of a novelist. So I'm very conscious of not letting research I've done or ideological things, or maybe if I have some larger kind of geopolitical axe to grind or something, I try very hard to make sure those are like secondary or tertiary concerns, that the main thing I'm trying to do is like tell a story. So I read everything I can, and I feel to the point where I feel like, not that I have like a checklist of, oh, these are details to include, but like I know this period or this area pretty well, or as well as like my characters who are always outsiders would know it. And then I just try to write really fast. And then like late in the process, the revision process, that's when I would worry about like, okay, actually they didn't have this car in this place, or, you know, those little details. So you think about it a lot, you get to know a lot. It's kind of like if you ever, I think novelist, it's good if you're a writer to learn literary theory really well and learn it well enough so that you can forget it. So it's not like in your forebrain when you write. I try to do the same thing with research, like think about it a lot. Understand the region or understand the conflict or whatever's happening so that I can just write it without worrying about it and then go back to that later. Because there's a way in which research can be like an excuse not to write. You know, I mean, it can be the kind of, because you can go down rabbit holes. You could theoretically never know a subject well enough to write about it. And I'm always wary of that. I'm also just kind of like lazy about research too. I just far prefer to make things up. At various times I've had this thought, like, this is amazing what I've learned. I'm going to write a nonfiction book. And then, like, you have to document all that. And it's just too much, you know? I'm like, instead, I'll just make this stuff up. And if anybody calls me out on it, I'll be like, God, it's a novel, you know? Give me a break. So that's not a very good answer, but that's my process.
No, that's great. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have another sneak question from Laura Thorpe-Hubbard. She says, this is wonderful. I have a question related to veteran writers who also attended college, but follow that experience in the military. How does that change the obligation?
And she said, what kind of wing writers?
Other
veterans. Okay, so I should say I'm not a veteran. I went to a military college, but I wasn't in the military. Tell me the last part again, I'm sorry.
How does that
change
the obligation, if at all?
Yeah, I mean, again, I think, you know, the notion of obligation is a very personal thing, and I'm not sure that if in the larger sense it would change any of that stuff. For me, it does. For me personally, it does. You know, I feel a certain, I don't know, it sounds so old-fashioned to say, like, a certain moral or ethical obligation, but I do. I mean, that's what it is. I don't know. There is not a well-lighted path from the Citadel in Charleston, South Carolina. And if you know of them, you know, probably because they started the Civil War, between that and, like, Divinity School in the Northeast. But it certainly gave me an interesting perspective. So I don't know. She gave a really good question. I'm giving her a bad answer. I'm sorry. Yeah, obligation, though, is just something that I think every writer has to suss out through, you know, your own form of fear and trembling. You got to figure out what it is you want to do. One of the things tomorrow in the lecture I want to talk about in violence, because obviously you can probably tell there's a fair amount of violence in the stuff I write. I was reading Maggie Nelson. If you know Maggie Nelson, she's a brilliant poet and cultural critic. And she says at one point in one of her books, you know, I often tell my students, like, I don't mind violence in your stuff, but it shouldn't be gratuitous. And Maggie Nelson says, at this point in our culture, is there any act of violence in any form of art that isn't gratuitous? And when I read that, it just sort of, like, stopped me cold. Because to some degree that she's right? We've seen these things happen so many times. And that's the kind of question, like, I feel like as a writer and as a human being, I have to sit with for a while. In the same sense, like, this notion of obligation, is there some higher thing you have to answer to? And I don't mean, like, higher power, but just, like, some higher sense of what you're about. I feel like I do, but I also recognize that is, a decision I've made. So, yeah, that's the best I got.
Hi. So, yeah, I was really interested in this idea of the intimacy of distance.
Uh-huh.
And if you could speak to, like, similarities and differences in how you've noticed its effect on, like, the way we are toward one each other, mm-hmm. like, maybe say post 9/11 and, like, now with climate change kind of, you know, being what it is.
Mm-hmm. That's something I feel like what you're asking, I think, is what I'm trying to reckon with, you know, in a larger sense. I don't know there. I mean, there's weird, incredibly strange, and maybe this is the farcical, thing where if you are an American, there are people out there who wish you harm, right? Who would very happily see you dead. You probably will never see them. You probably never will encounter them. They exist. They're out there. They have grievances, some of them very legitimate grievances, and some not, but some very legitimate grievances. But that doesn't mean you shouldn't load your pictures up to Instagram. Or that doesn't stop us from, you know, doing that. And I don't know, just I feel like we toggle between these things in a way. And part of this, I think, is the internet, and just the ubiquitous nature of everything that's going on, right? We toggle between these things so rapidly, it creates, I don't know, it's not a split personality. Maybe it's like a split in the personality if there's a difference. That to me is like this sense of the intimacy of distance. Yeah, I'm going nowhere with this, but I would suggest reading Joan Didion or Don DeLillo. They are the two of the most articulate writers, I think, about this. But it is something. Pico Iyer, the writer, made a really interesting observation in one of his essays. He said, until something like, I think, 1936, he cites, no one had ever experienced jet lag before, right? Which is kind of amazing if you think about it, right? Humans had been around for how many millions or whatever of years, and no one had ever had that sense, right, of when you cross and you cross multiple time zones, and suddenly the rhythms of your body are out of sync. And we take it completely for granted now. I think at some point we're going to look back on this period, or, you know, the last 20 or 25 years, and realize there has been some sort of shift in the way we experience the world. And probably because we're living through it gradually, we're not going to realize how radical it is. And it has something to do, I think, with moving between these larger kind of global geopolitical issues that are all around us, but also simultaneously disappear while being ever present. That doesn't make any sense when I say it, but I think maybe you kind of get what I'm saying. And I think that's kind of what I'm trying to, one of the things I'm trying to work out for myself, because it's the way it gets back to this kind of fundamental notion of how you see the world and how you see your place in the world, right? To some degree, I think as writers, and maybe not all writers, maybe this is just me, but I think we're trying to write ourselves into the world in the sense that we're trying to write ourselves into a world we can understand. That's it. And maybe the world's just got more difficult to understand than it has been, simply because we're more aware of it. And we're in one sense, right? That's wonderful, right? We have the ability to confront all sorts of injustices, but it's also absolutely overwhelming at the same time, right? I'm sorry not to give you a better answer there. I mean, talk about failure. yeah, but thank you for the question.
Hello. Can
Hi.
You hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm thinking a lot about place, and it seems like you've lived in many places and have written about many places. And you've also mentioned talking about navigating this like insider outsider position. Mm-hmm. And I'm curious to hear your experience of writing place and your entry points into writing place.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think my entry place is always writing about place as the outsider, because I've never felt like an insider. Like even in the community in which I grew up, I've always felt like a little bit of an interloper, you know? There's the writer Tom Franklin writing about a genre called grit lit, which is like rough Southern literature, talked about, he has a quote, he says that it's usually written by the sensitive kid at the dogfight. And that's an exaggeration for me, but it's not a huge exaggeration. I was like the bookish kid in really not bookish places growing up. So that's probably a pretty good experience for a writer, right? Not to feel like you fully belong, but to be present, to witness something. So when I think about place, this is another wonderful question. I mean, to one degree, I am completely shaped, I know, by place, by where I grew up, in the cultural forces and, you know, geographical forces and all those. But also, I feel like I kind of move through life never quite exactly fitting in place. And I realize that there's a certain absurdity to that. I'm like a cisgender white dude, you know? I mean, there's a huge amount of privilege that comes with that. So my sense of not belonging is purely self-imposed. But I always think of place and what I'm writing about. I'm always seeing that place through the eyes of someone who feels, maybe they do fit, but they feel as if they don't quite fit. And that gives me like this stable vista to look at places. Because you can't, I mean, you can't write your way, you can't know intimately the places I would want to write about. That would just be false, and I think it would be morally hazardous too, ethically hazardous. But I feel like I can approach them as who I am and engage with that. And what that is the kind of overprivileged, belatedly enlightened, still slightly naive American with, you know, your big busted liberal heart. And I can see the world through those lens, and I can write like from that purview. And I feel like maybe that gives me, the word's not permission. I mean, writers don't need permission. You can do whatever you want. It gives me sort of like private clearance to approach things I might not approach otherwise if I was trying to write like I really knew about them. Instead, I'm writing about them like, I don't know about this, but I know enough about it to see it from this perspective and to realize something is happening here. Does that make sense at all?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Well, about not belonging,
yeah,
at the Citadel, I'm sure being bookish, there was a little bit of a smell you had.
And then, yes.
And then at Yale Divinity, you probably had a certain...
Yeah.
Stench of the Citadel. So it's like, sure, there is just this one.
Yeah. I'm starting to think I'm a masochist. yeah, there's certainly some of that. But again, that's not a bad thing for a writer, right? Mm-hmm. I imagine I'm not the only person in this room who, to some degree, is driven to write because they are driven by a sense of not quite fitting, right? Of being kind of in between places. So
yeah, I know, you know, not to make this about the interviewer, but I played baseball for a while and I was the dork. And now here I'm actually the large person.
Right. Yeah. You're the jock or whatever. Yeah.
A lot of my humor doesn't land.
I get it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I get it.
Anyway, so like, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
6'2".
Yeah.
But in my locker room, you know, guys are 6'7".
Right. And they're like, what's that thing in your hand? You're like, oh, it's a book.
Yeah. It's like Herman Melville, man.
Yeah. That's right. You made a Melville joke earlier. No wonder that you were bullied. And I think, right, that's just something you got to embrace. That's who you are. Yeah. And that's a good thing to be.
Yeah. And it does put you in a certain position of watching and caring and you know, interested enough in something to write about it.
Yeah. No, absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, are there any more questions?
These people have been incredibly patient through my rambling and your expert titles. We should probably release them.
We should release them after you sign my Moby Dick question.
Call me Ishmael. That wasn't funny, but thank you for laughing. No, seriously, y'all, thank you so much. This has been an absolute pleasure, and I realize we have rambled and been I appreciate it. I enjoyed it very much. So thank you.
Yeah. And thank you, Mark.
And I wrote it on paper, so it's far more coherent, I assure you.
Thank you, Bill.